Well, hi, I'm Vince, also known as PleasantKenobi on the internet, and welcome to another Channel Fireball video. Not a list video this week, but more just a look at the new white staples that we got in Modern Horizons 2 and how they fit into the modern archetype of death and taxes. The meme that white gets the raw end of the stick in terms of playables has a basis in reality. For the most part, it's with reference to Commander, where white's bigger and more expensive splashy spells just don't tend to hold up, with the exception of some things like Smothering Tithe. And the colour's ability to keep up in card advantage kind of lags behind the other colours. White has some clearly defined edges in constructed magic, normally outside of Commander. It's very good at going wide, at being disruptive, and it has arguably some of the best, most efficient removal spells in the game. And some of these things struggle in Commander. Drawing those efficient removal spells is difficult with no card draw, and going wide is dangerous in a format where people pack a lot of wraths in Commander. But even outside of Commander and EDH, in things like Modern and Legacy, part of White's color identity has leaked into other parts of the pie. It used to be the main de facto go-to rule-setting color, with cards that would define rules for the game, stop you from drawing too many cards or casting more spells, but we've seen this leak into other colors. The most egregious of these are all non-symmetrical, which is a feature of White's hate. So arguably these are better, because they affect your opponent and not you. We've got Narset, the part of Veils from War of the Spark. We've got Hull Breacher, and we've got Opposition Agent, all of which, for the most part, felt like could have been white cards, but they ended up, well, not being. This problem has been acknowledged directly by the white representative of the Colour Council, Ari Nia, and by Gavin Verhey, who's a magic designer as well, in his YouTube series Good Morning Magic, where he did a very transparent look in a video at what the future of white might look like in terms of what they're getting as an identity. One of the issues with the ongoing conversation about what is going on with white at Wizards is that they work 2 years in the future. So with Commander Legends and Zendikar Rising and stuff now, we're starting to see the fruits of their labor, but it's taking time for us to start to see this. Modern Horizons 2 was brought with it perhaps the largest inroads to date in addressing these issues. The first card we're going to look at out of the three real good staples from this set is going to be Solitude, the white version of the Evoke cycle. Solitude is absolutely solid. I've been playing this week 1-2 copies in Modern Death and Taxes on the channel and on stream, and it's coming clutch against matchups primarily things like Death's Shadow whilst on its Evoke mode. The most exciting thing about Solitude though is that, well, it's got two modes, right? It's a free spell if you exile something from hand, but you can also blink it either after evoking or if it's on board. So you can evoke it into play for free by exiling a white card from hand and then activate your Aether Vial, put a Flicker Wisp into play, targeting it and reset it. And when it comes back at that point, it's then entered the battlefield and stays there whilst exiling a second thing. And you can do this with Restoration Angel, instant speed, Flicker Wisp off a vial, or if you're feeling particularly spicy, Eldrazi Displacer. I like Displacer in grindier metagames, so it might not be the best place to be right now, but if you're on green-white or white variant specializing in Eldrazi with Eldrazi Temple, I think Displacer is a legitimate include. There is literally a highlight video on my YouTube channel of me playing the Flash Solitude for 5 mana on end step, untapping, playing around having 6 mana, and using Displacer to activate twice, to Flicker Solitude twice, and just eat things on their board. It is an incredible end of the battlefield effect to recur with your Flicker effects, especially if you can cheat it by like evoking and flickering it with Displacer. The other interesting place in Modern right now where Solitude is pretty good is the rising popularity of Through the Breach as a archetype. Louis Scott Vargas endorsed this in one of the CFB Extra newsletters not so long back, so it's obvious people are going to be flocking to this deck. It is the blue-red control deck with a combo finish, so old twin players can really get their rocks off with this stuff. Solitude allows you to tap out, to prompt your opponent to put Emrakul in off of Through the Breach, and then you can get rid of Emrakul using Solitude because it's not a spell. Well, it is a spell, but it's a creature spell. It's not instant or sorcery, so it can get Emrakul, albeit whilst giving them 15 life. Next up in terms of staples is Esper Sentinel, a card that will be popular as a white pseudo-ristic study in Commander, but also gives decks like Death and Taxes in Modern a way to recuperate or compensate for their lack of card advantage. Historically, we've utilized cards like Blade Splicer to get virtual card advantage. It'll enter the battlefield, it'll make a 3-3 body, and then we'll Flicker Wisp it, Displace it, Restoration Angel it to make more 3-3s. It's virtual card advantage. Instead of like drawing the cards for the card advantage, it instead generates more bodies on board, which is something that Ari Nia literally said when they appeared on the episode of Dice to Removal, where me and Brian, the professor over at Tyne Community College, where we interviewed Ari, asking them about where white is going. We talked about how this is a thing that white does, where other colours don't do it as well. That said, generating a load of 1-1s or 3-3s isn't as good as just raw dog drawing your cards, because when you draw cards, you can draw your efficient answers, your plowshares, your path to exiles, your wrath of gods, your oblivion rings. Gideons and History of Benalias and such have brought good, strong mini engines that generate value over the turns and develop a board to white in recent sets. That doesn't help you draw your efficient answers like Swords to Plowshares or Wrath. I say recent sets. Gideon is like 1,000-year-old at this point. I just feel like an old man saying that. Esper Sentinel promises some of that raw card draw, giving you cards when your opponent can't pay or decides not to pay for their non-creature spells. Sentinel's power level is on the extreme ends of the scale in my experience. Against spell-based combo decks or decks with a lot of setup, things that are looking to cast opts, explores, or use its removal to pick apart your board, it's going to end up giving you one or two cards or being super inefficient in trying to avoid doing so. Then when you add things like Thalia, Guardian of Thraben, or the Leon and Arbiter plus a Ghost Quarter to really tax their mana, they're either going to let you draw or they're going to be able to do nothing other than play their setup spells. So it's good there. Some decks in the format though will cast no non-creature spells. I played against Elves this week, I played against Merfolk, I played against Humans. All of these decks do not care for casting non-creature spells, and thus your Esper Sentinel is just a 1-1. Which is terrible. I was playing it as a 4 of opting not to play Giver of Runes this week to try and really get some reps in with Esper Sentinel and play about 20 games with it. Ultimately, I ended up signing all 4 out or keeping all 4 in. It was that polarizing for the most part. So I'm not sure how many we should play. I think it's definitely valid in a spell combo-based metagame, but the exact number, I'm unsure of at the moment. And lastly, we have a card that I said was garbage in previous season, and it turns out it's actually kind of nuts. Sanctifier Envec was criticized by a few people, myself included, for not just being rest in peace on a body. And whilst that would have been nice and powerful, it would have been a different card and perhaps not as good in the current modern metagame. While Sanctifier is a rest in peace, strictly speaking, for red and black cards, it exiles them in graveyards on ATB and stops them going to the graveyard, it opens up some interesting opportunities. Firstly, we can Violet in, we can Coco it in, and we can also flicker it with Restoration Agent to save it as well. That's great. But that would have been the same if it was just a bear with a rip on it. The fact that it only eats red and black cards in graveyards means we can play Eternal Witness with it in green, white, D&T, or we can play Kitchen Finks, which is a bit old school, but it allows you to play it and have it be reset against Jund whilst you're still messing with their graveyard and having a threat that they can't actually kill with their targeted removal. However, those things are more the cherry on top of a rather sweet cake in the fact that a pro-red, pro-black body in current modern is ridiculous. At the moment, we're seeing a resurgence of red-black Hollow One decks where this can block every threat they play and is impervious to all their removal except for the titular Hollow One. Crab Vine decks as well that are looking to self-mill. Again, it can't block the Vengevine, but it can block all of the black zombie creatures they bring back. That's also great against Dredge. And all of those decks will struggle to kill it too. This card is impervious to Push, to Bolt, to Assassin's Trophy, to Dismember, and to Lightning Axe. That's a lot of good removal that doesn't even scratch it. This card is a weird case of where its protections are super relevant in the current climate, and elevating it from just good to kind of absurd. I even got to dominate a New Age Living End slash Reanimator player who was trying to bring back bodies with, well, Living End and other reanimation spells, because most of those bodies were black, and all the cycling creatures to enable Living End were black or red. This was incredible in that matchup. So Sentinel's pretty good, Solitude is very good, and Sanctifier Envec, whilst not main boardable, is easily the best card this set has given us. I'm currently playing 3 in my sideboards, and they come in against so many matchups. I'm starting to wonder if the format pushes more towards the Hollow One, Asmo, Deca, Doodah decks. We might want to have some of these main board. The card is crazy good. So let me know what you think of my evaluation of the modern D&T staples. I'll be playing some more D&T next week as well, probably on stream 2, trying to get that elusive 5-0 as I haven't got one with the current iteration of the deck. Let me know what you think in the comments below. I've been Vince, also known as PleasantKenobi on the internet. If you enjoyed the content, smash that like button. And if you pick up anything from the ChannelFireball store from the link down below, use the code Kenobi to help support me and the channel. And check me out on YouTube too as well, PleasantKenobi on YouTube, but make a lot of magic content. That's it. Thanks for watching. Thanks for listening to me ramble about white playable cards. Poh, who would have thought? In modern as well, not just legacy. Wild. I'll see you all soon. Ta-ta for now.